Dreamscape presents King of the Blues, The Rise and Reign of B.B. King by Daniel DeVise. Narrated by Cary, Hite. Introduction. Back inside a jail was one place B.B. King thought he would never go. He had spent only a single night in the cell, after a white cop flagged him down on a Mississippi highway for doing 80 in a 60-mile-per-hour zone. That was in 1950. B.B. was then a struggling musician and underpaid radio performer in his 20s, still picking cotton to make ends meet, racing to a gig in a borrowed car. The fine was $90. B.B. didn't have it, and the imperious cop knew it. 2 decades later, on September 10, 1970, B.B. stood on the cusp of his 45th birthday. In those 45 years, Riley B. King had risen from penniless sharecropper to sidewalk busker to Memphis DJ to chart-topping singer to King of the Blues. Guitar heroics defined popular music in 1970, and B.B. King was the first guitar hero. B.B.'s story was the story of the Great Migration, the northward journey that delivered millions of African Americans from southern plantations into the urban north. B.B. had hitchhiked out of Mississippi, found fame in Memphis, and then set out across the nation in a bus called Big Red. After 2 decades on the fabled Black Chitlin' circuit, B.B. had crossed over, capping his symbolic breakthrough with a triumphant performance for a throng of white hippies at San Francisco's pot-scented Fillmore Auditorium in 1967. After that, B.B.'s audience had changed color. He played mostly for whites now. But this gig was different. A show inside Chicago's infamous Cook County Jail, conceived by an African-American warden to entertain 2,400 inmates, most of them African-Americans. B.B. rejoiced at performing for black people again. B.B. and his band entered the jail around 11 that morning. Stony-faced guards patted them down and escorted them through heavy steel doors, which closed with a sickening clang. The group proceeded down endless, windowless tunnels, past offices and cells and the jail's electric chair, to a mess hall, followed everywhere by eyes empty of everything except deep, numbing pain, one musician recalled. B.B. chatted with the inmates, trying to push down the primal terror of being locked inside a prison, a place that felt final and scary and rock hard. A beefy guard shadowed the blues man, his eyes searching for the flashing blade of a shank. Most of the men were young enough to be B.B.'s children. One by one, they shared stories of languishing inside cells for months without end, awaiting trial, unable to post bail, powerless to leave. After a tasteless meal, guards led the band outside to a bleak and gusty courtyard. The entourage headed toward a small stage, a raised platform where condemned men had once been hanged. A stubborn wind tore sheet music from the musicians' stands and whisked it over the forbidding 30-foot stone walls. But a warm autumn sun shone on the yard, and the air was a perfect 70 degrees. The weather had held, and that was good, for organizers had committed to a concert on this day. B.B. was playing for free, but his label had spent $10,000 on transportation, salaries, and equipment to record the performance for eventual release as a live album. The musicians warmed up, played a sound check, and jammed with men from the jailhouse band as the audience filed out to the yard. 200 female inmates sat in folding chairs at stage left. More than 2,000 men sprawled out in roped-off sections of grass. The men on death row remained locked in their cells, listening through opened windows. The concert began at 1 p.m. "Hello out there," a female jail official announced. She introduced the white sheriff and a prominent white judge to the jumpsuited crowd, setting off a chorus of violent boos that echoed across the yard. 50 guards with thick batons and 50-caliber semi-automatic rifles roamed the perimeter and perched atop towers. Concerts didn't get much more real. Sensing tension in the air, the announcer hurried things along, beckoning, "Would you please come forth, Mr. King?" And then B.B. climbed atop the old gallows, clad in an olive-green plaid suit. A gunshot blast from Sonny Freeman's snare drum announced the first song, "Every Day I Have the Blues." The six-piece band raced forward, shuffling in matching powder blue suits, propelled by Freeman's galloping swing beat. Beebe spun the volume knob to awaken Lucille, his sinuous, symmetrical Gibson guitar. He played his first notes, climbing up to a blue third, bending the string with his powerful fingers to rise from D-flat to D-natural, then dancing back down and ending the solo phrase on a sustained note. Beebe flailed his left wrist up and down to create the shimmering vibrato that was his trademark. Beebe felt that he and Lucille spoke with the same voice, one picking up where the other left off. A few bars later, it was Beebe's turn. Every day I have the blues, he sang, a rich booming baritone that formed way back in his clenched throat. 2 minutes later, the song was over, and the yard erupted in applause and cheers. This audience surely could relate to the blues. Now the band slid into Beebe's signature song, How Blue Can You Get? Lucille unleashed an oral fireworks display that recounted the history of urban blues, much of it written by Beebe on his guitar. Soaring bends, rapid-fire staccato bursts, and sustained tremulous tones. And then Beebe sang, I have been downhearted, baby, ever since the day we met, he growled, reminding his audience that he was not just the world's greatest blues guitarist, but also an archetypal rhythm and blues singer. Beebe sang, and Lucille cried, and the crowd talked and cried and shouted back. As Beebe slowed into a campy feminine reading of the song's climactic bridge, the audience clamor threatened to overwhelm the band, a release of pure electric energy that Beebe breathed in like oxygen. Much as Beebe's new white fans adored him, they did not know how to engage, how to participate in a B.B. King show, any more than they would have known what to do in an African-American church. But here at the jail, as the band proceeded into an obscure 1950s single titled Worry, 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 Beebe called out to the audience and the audience responded, singly and collectively. Throw your arms around him, he cried, and the crowd shouted back, Yeah! Hold him close to you, Yeah! Look him straight in the eye. Yeah! The song ended. Now, Beebe reached back almost 20 years to sing and play his first big hits, 3 o'clock Blues and You Know I Love You, songs he mostly saved for black audiences. He knew that many in this crowd had heard them the first time around. This was Beebe King, blues crooner. Don't forget Sweet 16, someone cried. All right, baby. Beebe cooed. He played that one next. Some of the loudest cheers came from scattered male inmates wearing dresses and wigs. At first, the band mistook them for women. The concert climaxed with a slow-burning take on The Thrill Is Gone, the song that had secured Beebe a future in the pop music pantheon of white America. I'm free, free, free now, baby, Beebe roared. The men in the grass and the women in the chairs, not free, roared back. Looking out across the sea of black faces made me sad and glad, Beebe recalled. Sad that so many brothers were behind bars. Glad that I was reaching out to my own people. Such moments reminded Beebe of the miles he had traveled and of the sun-bleached sharecropper cabin where his journey had begun. Chapter 1. Sharecropper. Beebe King's father, Albert King, was born on February 28, 1907. The King family crisscrossed Mississippi in a perennial search for farm work. Albert probably entered the world in Glaston, a pinprick of a place in southern Mississippi, 100 miles north of the Gulf of Mexico. Events tore Albert's family asunder. His mother left his father and promptly died. A sister perished as well. Infant Albert and his father migrated 200 miles north to join their kin in Monroe County, part of the larger expanse of hill country, a rugged slab of northeastern Mississippi bordering Tennessee on the north and Alabama on the east. Sometime after 1910, Albert's father exited his life, leaving Albert in the care of an older brother named Riley, who in turn deposited Albert with a sharecropper family named Love and vanished into the mists. Albert joined the Love family as an adoptive nephew. They lived in Sunflower County, part of the fabled Mississippi Delta. Flat and fertile, the Delta lay west of Hill Country along the Arkansas border, the cradle of Mississippi's cotton industry. The Loves would carry Albert out to the fields in a tub, draped with a cotton sack to keep the mosquitoes at bay. Nora Ella Pulley, Bibi's mother, was probably born in 1908 in Chickasaw County, a hill country province named for the Indian tribe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.